that we teach you. That one is what we're shifting out of completely. That's the paradigm shift.
But are we? Is there something that will address that in the way we're going to teach senior high school?
I guess it's the way the training that teach the pedagogy.
If you have the same people teaching the same subject,
it's a pedagogy of senior high school.
It will change.
I guess this is a revolution in terms of the way even our higher education teachers teach cannot be the same way we teach before.
Mm-hmm.
Madam Chair. Yes, it's a way of teaching now, a different way of learning, that the students now should really be responsible for their own learning, like leaders of their own learning. There's a book called They Are Leaders of Their Own Learning. It's so important that they will not be teacher dependent. In fact, the teacher does not want them to be the only source of information, but the teacher is the one that guides them, to help them, to coach them, to find the necessary information, which will make them lifelong learners, which is very, very important. The word embedded is very much used, because really there's a lot of integration now. And it's not only the content, but a lot of the values that we want our students to have are really inside now. A lot of the material that is being taken up. So it's not so much as content, but really competency-based, value-based type of learning. And one thing, though, that I'd like to bring up also is that we're always saying, what does industry expect of our students, the ones that come out of our own institutions? But I'd also like to find out, how are our young people, how do they decide what jobs they are going to take? It's not only that, this is the best job, it will give me so much money and make me very important to society. But I think many young people now look for jobs that are creative, innovative, flexible, and interestingly enough, what is the CSR of that company? So I think that reflects the type of values, I think, that we are developing in our students.
Thank you. Now, I apologize to Mr. Rigor. My attention was shifted when I moved to the academicians, and as I said, once na pinagsalita ko yung DepEd and CHED, haba na yung ano. But of course, because they are the ones we look towards for the answer. So, Mr. Garrick, by all means, take a step back on the earlier topic on curriculum, if you have comments there, and then go ahead with any comments you have also on the transition and the preparation for the shift.
Good afternoon, everyone. Madam Chair. First of all, for everyone's benefit, Philippine Business for Education is the voice of the business community in matters concerning education reform in the country. So, first of all, we would like to affirm our commitment in pushing for the proper and complete implementation of the K-12 reform, because we see that the long-term benefits outweigh whatever harms may be present in the current scheme. In terms of curriculum, our interest here is the idea of bridging the skills and jobs mismatch of our graduates. We see the value of getting highly qualified workforce, especially when they enter the working arena. Towards this end, in terms of curriculum, we support a curriculum that is aligned with the in-demand jobs now and in the future. So the curriculum must be able to reflect the necessary skills that is needed by the industry that will allow the students to be employed once they graduate in college. Secondly, the curriculum, the K-12 curriculum, must also consider the locality of the school, the primary industries present in those localities, like, for example, agriculture, shipping, etc. And I think that's what DepEd is currently doing, and we laud them for that. Towards this end, what we have done in PBED was to first, we have forged partnerships with the industries and the academes, with industry and academe, through a council in order to be able to really focus on the issues on the curriculum and craft possible recommendations to align the curriculum to the needs of the market or the industry. And second, we have also secured the commitment of hundreds of universities through an event we did last year. They signed the Manila Declaration on Higher Education. A lot of issues we were able to discuss there, but one of the main issues there was their commitment for K-12. So that's it for now.
So let's go back to Dr. Giselle just gave us an overview, no, of the opportunities for UP to help in the development of these modules. How long will it take for that to be developed if once this is approved?
Madam Chair, present, CHED already has a plan to pilot, adopt a school program, as I understand it, in 2015. And UP's proposal actually is to commence in August 2016. But because CHED is asking us to participate in this pilot study, then I think we will find a way to do it.
Well, yeah, because that's the thing. I mean, yes. It launches in 2016. So if you want to, and the problem with members of Congress, and I guess others who have concerns is DepEd won't be ready by 2016. Mm-hmm. So if you want to try to address that concern,
right,
that should be the position that you present to the UP board, that now is the time to do it and yes, not in 2016, because that's the whole opposition here, that you know, we're not ready to roll this out. So whatever contributions that any sector can come up with should ideally happen now to help assist in preparation.
So I must say that this has not even been approved yet by our chancellors, but we thought that this is a good opportunity to present
That's what I'm just saying. I'm happy that you presented to me, but whatever you have to do, you got to do it fast, because sayang naman. I mean, I laud it, but you know, if UP takes its time in approving this and it goes through the usual lengthy processes, it defeats the purpose, which is something we've been discussing in the board, so let's not go into
There's another development in UP that would benefit the public school, senior high school in particular. We are developing instruments. It's acronym VISER, Versatile Instruments for Science and Science Research Education. It's funded by UP and the DOST. We are developing 60 instruments that can be used in labs to measure any natural phenomenon like oscillation or voltage or temperature or pH. Many of our high schools do not have this, but we're developing it in the National Institute of Physics, and it's requiring a lab manual or like a book with experiments that would make use of the instruments. So when we teach K-11 12, it's not all about, you know, just simulated experiments or lectures. We need to get the hands of the students wet in the labs and in the field. And so one way of doing this is to manufacture our own lab instruments. So we have the prototypes of these instruments already in the National Institute of Physics.
Okay.
So that's very important.
That was a concern raised by Mr. Bartholomew. So it's a question of how many, how soon, and yes, how many of those can be rolled out. So anyway, let's move along. Can we hold your response later so we can consolidate, no? Let's go from left to right this time. Comments and concerns, suggestions on addressing it's actually the gap created by the demand, the new positions that need to be filled, specific to that. Okay, Dr. Esther, let's go.
I'd like to mention about the CHED project in coordination with us, with our university and the others, on the CHED, on the K-12 engagement program. Mm-hmm. The project will develop online materials to support senior high school. and the colleges and universities that CHED would identify will work together so that materials for senior high will support the needs of senior high school, especially starting 2016. The work starts now in 2015. The other work that we're doing...
Wait, before you go to the other one, so this online material will be available when? Because my question is, and this is where the experts need to educate me, how much training is needed? Because obviously, you know, you can take a one-day course, a one-week course, and take or get a master's degree. But what is the minimum level of competence in terms of hours that we would like to see our senior teachers have? I don't know that answer, and it's probably not one answer. It's probably depending on the subject matter they're teaching. So should DepEd answer that first, and then I go back to all these other requirements? Because I really wouldn't know.
Madam Chair, just a very broad answer. For the senior high school teachers of DepEd high schools, mm-hmm. there are two general sources of teachers. The first one are our current high school teachers who can move up to 11 and 12.
And how will you train them?
For their training, yeah. they are accustomed to the ways of teaching in basic education, but we might need to upgrade their content knowledge so that they can teach the higher levels of physics, math, sciences, English, and so on. The other...
Before you go to the other one, how are you going to do that?
For
Do they need a one-month training program? Do they need to take a sabbatical and over the summer prepare for that? Interestingly enough, they will be involved in the election process in 2016, just before you open school. I don't know if anyone really thought of that, but yeah, so I don't know what, I mean, that's why I said before you go to the next one, sila muna. So, and again, it probably depends on the subject matter, I don't know. I mean, offhand.
In the case of these teachers, what the department is currently doing, we're profiling our teachers, looking at how many of them are in certain positions, for example, teachers 1 to 4, master teachers 1 to 4, looking at their educational background, how many of them have bachelor's level for certain specialization, how many have master's degrees in certain specializations, and so on. That data will then inform the work in progress teacher design, teacher program, teacher training design, which we have yet to finalize. It is something that we will
but
be...
But offhand, can you hazard a guess? Like minimum of 2 weeks training, 1 month training? Is this something they do at home over the period of 2 months? I mean...
The current junior high school teacher training program
yes.
ranges from 5 to 7 days. I think that is the minimum, even for senior high. Only 5 to 7 days.
Go ahead.
I guess the support the DepEd training. What we actually are developing teacher's guides, okay? And teacher's guides basically for the core courses, especially for the STEM. For the moment, our first phase has to do with the core courses that are connected to STEM and business, because these are the regular college courses that are there. So teacher's guides in digital form, which takes into account also even videos and multimedia stuff that's already there, so that it is something that can be put in the learning resource whatever you call it in DepEd, and it's and then to connect to that, and that's the one that we have a project together with PNU and the normal schools. We have a project with UP in connection to this, and this is this year. The materials development is expected to happen between now and September. So by September, there are materials that are there. The faculty development part, you can talk about faculty development orientations, but we're also thinking of the adopt the K-12 schools for particular subjects and help train the teachers there. It's easier, it's clearer now for the private schools, because the private schools, we're dealing with some of them already, we're dealing with some of the organizations of private schools in terms of the training in October. In terms of the training of the adopt a school, and that is something we're working on with DepEd. So I think that's The thing is, they should be oriented already by now. You're correct about that. By before 2016. But 2016, I think you have to make a distinction between what our faculty will be doing in 2016 that still connects to K-12 training, because they have nothing, they are not teaching, which is the job now of the HEIs, from the needs to the need to actually train now and to actually develop the materials now in preparation for 2016. So we are hitting both. The plan, I think, of UP is a plan for what the UP faculty will be doing in 2016. That still is a continuing continuing training.
Okay, so you're talking about how to address. That's not my concern now.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So this hearing.
Yeah, that's another problem which actually was discussed in the first hearing, like, you know, what do we do now with all these?
So this hearing is the training that has to be done now.
Yes.
And right now,
to prepare those
we are
teachers.
Developing, yeah, to prepare all the teachers. We're developing the teaching guides as well as digitized, as well as basic teaching guides. That will complement the textbooks that are being called. There's a call for textbooks of DepEd. But for now, such teaching guides are being developed in collaboration with different kinds of teams coming from the different higher education institutions. So that is ongoing, and that by September we have such teaching guides for the first phase courses, which are really pre-calculus and basic calculus, general math, stats and probability, general biology, general chemistry, general physics, earth science, physical science, applied economics, fundamentals of accountancy, business and management, and organization and management. That's phase one. By September, you would have the materials. Some of these are core courses. Some of them are specialized in the STEM track. Then we move on. But there is already a plan for the training of faculty, even starting in October. But a plan, too, in terms of HEIs adopting the K-12 schools in an area in particular fields, because they have the knowledge part of it. Yeah, that's one. The other one, the source of our faculty are the ones coming from HEIs and going to senior high school. What they need is pedagogy. The source of the ones coming from basic ed and upgrading to senior high school, what they need is content. Then that may not even be enough. So we are also developing a program together with DepEd, a program where you will now allow a graduate of physics to teach directly in senior high school with a mentor in senior high school, and with the possibility of getting the additional units so that they will be able to get the LET or to get their licensure. So that's like the teach to the program, teach for the Philippines thing, but it is really for senior high school. So that one is a different training program, but that's being developed now, and all of this simultaneously. Yeah.
Be prepared to explain to the Senate the first week of May is your numbers of around 31,000 new teachers and how they will all be trained by then, and that's the minimum. So, yeah, that was really the purpose of this hearing, for you to hear the concerns and anticipate the questions that will be asked of you. Did you finish your statement? I'm sorry. I don't know if I cut you off at some point. You did. Okay.
Yeah, let me make a wild guess, because when I was at DOST, I was monitoring the number of qualified teachers in high school level. That was not too far away from where we are right now, but when I left DOST, the current pool of qualified teachers in math is at the level of 50%. For physics, 8 to 10%. Biology, about 25%, and this would include those who have taken BS Bio to become medical doctors, but were not successful in going to that field, they're teaching in high school. Chemistry as well would include chemical engineering graduates, about 25%. I guess it will be similar.
Before you finish, these percentages are percentages of what? Demand?
My estimate on the current, on the pool of qualified teachers at high school level.
But without even going into...
Yes, but I'm sure the DepEd data will give us the real picture as of now, whether it has improved significantly or would be moving up
more
a little
or less
bit.
The same.
But the kind of training that will be required, since there are engineers who may become or who may be enticed to go to teaching, as Commissioner Bautista said, this will be on PCK and definitely on pedagogy, to allow them to teach specific courses at senior high school level. However, those who are qualified have to be trained as well to handle the new courses in the K-12 program. The gap definitely is there. And my feeling is that they should not be pushed up to senior high school if they have to remain in junior high school level, and if the subjects remain to be the same, then there's a need for content training if they will continue to teach those subjects. I'm sure that the universities will be happy to collaborate with CHED and with DepEd on the teacher training programs. But for now, as part of transition, I believe that the participation of the universities will be very, very essential. This is where we have content specialists in different fields. And if they handle the senior high school level courses, then they have to be given training as well. Because this is a different cup of tea. It's a different way of teaching at senior high school level. In college, you simply have to do your part, not knowing that there are certain competencies at high school level. So I think when programs are packaged, we have to be aware on the pool of faculty members that will handle certain courses at certain levels, given their backgrounds as well.
Well,
thank you.
So that brings me back to my concern. Assuming the figures haven't changed much, you mentioned we are at about 25% for, what was it, math? Can you just...
The reality is the most number that teacher education institutions graduate are those in mathematics.
And that's...
Because you don't have labs, you don't have those facilities required at college.
Okay.
And because for a long, long time, there were no investments, especially on state institutions. So they produce math graduates.
And
for physics...
For math, what's the figure? What was the figure?
My estimate, because
at
the time, about 50%. If we go higher to 60 or 75, then that's good.
And then for physics, what
physics,
was it?
Physics, the most number of graduates for physics teaching at high school level is PNU with two classes. The next, perhaps, is San Carlos. UP would produce about 4 people in physics, or at most 10 people. So this is a pool of limited manpower
ilan
in the area of physics teaching.
Ilan yung percent you mentioned earlier?
At that time, it's about 8% qualified teachers. And that would also include, by the word qualified, this would include engineering graduates teaching in physics. So the operational definition is the graduates in teacher ed institutions that have specialized in these courses, plus those people specializing in the fields that have opted to teach at high school level and that have taken pedagogy courses to support their taking the licensure examinations. Mm.
Okay, so anyway, the point I want to make is that assuming these figures haven't changed much, no, or even if they've improved 10%, whatever, what are we going to do if we're not ready in 14 months, no? That's June, next June. Are we still going to offer these courses, or do we then say we roll out 2016, but we will not have as many STEM tracks? Let's limit it to the number of schools that will be equipped with the qualified teachers. Because I go back to my point where if there's a huge demand anyway for competence in English, basic communication skills, then there may be jobs in tourism and BPO and general office management and whatnot. As opposed to just, and I use this term very lightly, but you know, jumping on the bandwagon, knowing that STEM is very important, no diminishing of that importance, and yet not prepared to teach them well. Or even if you had quite a few ready, the next question is, when we acknowledge that one type of teacher would lack content training and the other type of teachers, the ones moving from HEIs to senior or those who are specialized in their practice who are willing to teach, I don't know how many of them there are, on pedagogy. And are we now equipped to teach all this? Are we? Like, have we done a survey of who's going to do the training? Like, PNU, how many? UP, sabi mo nga, we'll create this thing, and then master teachers to roll it out. Yun. So you'll have to answer those questions in 2 weeks. Those are the questions that, at that point, really need to be answered.
Madam Chairman, my suggestion is for a short-term and long-term solution. The short-term solution, which should come in under the Marshall Plan for supporting the senior high school, will include the training or the adaptive school program, perhaps, because in the case of BNU, we're looking at certain schools within Manila. Like, for example, we will adapt Arroyo High School for one or two tracks, say science and physical education or sports ed. And that means that our faculty members will take care of the training of teachers in Arroyo High School. If they need our labs, then they can use the labs at PNU. Correspondingly, for our other network of universities under the National Network of Normal Schools, the model is simply like that for Cebu, for Bicol, and other areas, so that there is direct contact between the university faculty and the teachers. And at the end of the school year, what we intend to do would be to come up with common materials that they can use so that they are guided on how to manage their senior high school program in the tracks. The long-term approach, of course, there would be other training programs that will be required as indicated earlier by Commissioner Bautista. But the long-term approach will require a Marshall Plan for producing future teachers who would be able to handle senior high school. What is important, I think, is to identify which model are we going to use for the science track. Korea has a very good model for identifying science high schools. Other than the Academy for Science and Technology at senior high school level, that provides for the creme de la creme that would go to the Korean Institute of Science and Technology. So I think for that particular one, if we want to be competitive, we need to develop the system for producing our future scientists and engineers. It cannot be a simple way of running a track for science and technology. If we want engineers and scientists, then maybe the Korean model is something that we can look at. If we want the creation of future products for the Philippines, I'm sure our colleagues in the science community would have some advice on developing our competitiveness. Thailand is a good model for putting up the science and technology park, and for which all PhDs from abroad, they bring to the park, let them teach the young. They have built a hotel-type facility that allow for training of the young people from elementary to high school level. They spend for them such that these scientists, the new PhDs, whether they were given scholarships in the country or abroad, they take care of the young. They do their own incubation projects, and then after a time, after their contract has been expired, then they would go to industry. I think it has to be a whole system of development. It cannot be a separate strategy for DepEd for K-12. If we want a bigger picture, then we have to put together the pieces. Thank you.
Dr. Torres, did you want to make a statement here on this topic?
Yes, Madam Chairperson. In addition, I'd like to view the awareness in this K-12 in terms of looking at it rather than K-12, we should look at it in terms of K-16. my worry, Madam Chairperson, is the output of this key to 12 are entering higher education, and we train so much that we do lots of preparations in the 11 and 12. But right now in the higher education, it's about 50% of the 47,000 faculty members are still in the BS level. And I'm worried that we might be producing a very good 11 and 12, and it might deteriorate when they enter 13 because of the lack of preparations of our faculty in the higher education. We have a proposal in PASOK, Madam Chairperson. We take this opportunity to train our faculty that needing MS degree and PhD. We have an estimate of about 5.5 billion for these faculty members, and 16 and 17 is the right time. And the faculty now teaching in the as part-time faculty teaching the G subjects can take care of the subjects that would be left by this faculty. So that's actually, if you look at the capacity of our faculty in higher education, I'm referring to the issues with this new dimensions of our higher education, it's now scaling up 11 and 12. We need, I think, to really prepare for the 13, 14, 15, 16, Madam Chairperson. Thank you.
That's obviously an area that we cannot neglect. Now, we think I mentioned that in passing earlier. And we'll include that in the next hearing when we talk about the fund that Ed has to cough up. Okay, this way. And Mr. Dionisio, anything else or anything else you want to add on this one?
Actually, we look at the transition period as some form of an opportunity to produce what we call a golden age of teachers, because during the transition period they will be given the opportunity to take postgraduate studies. For those who don't have masteral degrees, they could take a masteral course, and for masteral courses, those with master's degree, they could take the PhD. So maybe after the transition period, we will have a golden age of a tertiary education professors or teachers. And I would also like to comment on for tertiary education institutions, although we were assured by DepEd during the last month that tertiary education institutions with, I think, level one accreditation would be granted permits to teach, to offer senior high school. So hopefully we could, our member schools will be able to get the permit so that we could start preparing for the transition. Because for a while we felt like we were in limbo because we don't know how to prepare, since the preparation hinges on the approval or the issuance of the permits. Because our institutions during the transition period will be lacking college students, so we were hoping if we offer senior high school, at least malalessen yung ano yung yung losses on enrollees. And also we are currently hoping that the vouchers, hopefully it would also be increased, because we acknowledge that there might be limitations on increasing the amount of the vouchers, but I don't think it's impossible. But we were hoping, because right now we find the amount, especially in Metro Manila, baka mukhang kulang, because ito sana could be used by public school students as tuition to enter senior high school in private schools. So those are some of the concerns of private higher education institutions. Thank you.
It's a quick question. No? Are you now going into the process of accrediting these HEIs who want to offer? And what stage are we at? Like they're literally individually being processed now?
Just a quick update, Madam Chair. So far, we've issued 334 provisional permits.
HEIs?
Mix of private high schools and private HEIs. And then a batch of 1,122
Do you know what the difference is? Because the private high schools, these are the ones who have been applying over the years for K-12, no? So
aren't all the
private high schools going to want to offer that anyway, or is that an assumption, there's still no basis for that? I just assumed if you offer high school, you would offer senior high school.
There are over 4,000 private high schools nationwide.
Mm-mm.
Around maybe 700, 800 of them have higher education or connected to higher education programs. Now, if you say around 3,000 are purely high school, there's a number of mainly sectarian or Catholic schools mm-hmm. that are really small, and they cannot afford even to expand in 11 and 12 just to address their own students.
But the general rule is, I'm just curious, I just assumed kasi, so is that just more of a exception to the rule, you know, these very small schools, baka they're even their land space, their target market in the air is very small, I don't know. Is it more the exception that they're not going to apply for senior high, or you can't say yet?
We'll check ma'am our data and give you a more definite answer during the
report. Because nga, that's my question. I want you to differentiate the data between the high schools that are applying to offer senior high and then the HEIs who are applying for a permit. And I'm also curious, would these be temporary permits to cover? Are they only interested in doing it during this interim that they want their instructors to be fully, you know, to have jobs, or do they then now, what is the long-term plan of CHED also, of DepEd also, and CHED? Is it because for SUCs, and I don't know if the reason, the rationale applies, you're discouraging SUCs to have their high schools. So this is nothing to do with K-12, I think, but just that was just a policy of CHED, right? I just want to know where all of this is heading now.
Okay,
the permits. Ma'am, just the first question about the nature of permits. Permits, legally speaking, are provisional and temporary. But what private schools do after several years of offering the program, they apply for government recognition. And then recognition is in place unless it is otherwise revoked by government.
But giving this once-in-a-lifetime situation where we're at, where we're adding 2 years, wouldn't it be interesting to find out what their plan is? I mean, I think it's just a tick box. Like, are you really just doing this provisionally to make do? I would want to know, because that also affects your plans in rolling out more senior highs, as opposed to they say, no, it's a good business model, we're going to keep it, and we're going to hire more teachers.
I think for private schools, at least the ones that have been given permits already, I think this is a longer-term thing. This is not just a one-shot, two-year
program. All I'm saying is
program.
It would be good for you to find out. I'm not asking you naman to second-guess every single one.
Yeah.
But
it's the SUCs. I think that's something that we'll be discussing with PASOK. But right now, until we finish all the mapping, we're saying that SUCs will really be needed when you do not have the STEM track. I mean, we have to offer the STEM track. If there are very few schools offering the STEM track, we have to attract more students to STEM, and we have the laboratory. So that is clear. Now whether it's temporary 2 years or not, will, I guess, depend upon the spread of our STEM. We really have to strengthen STEM. But as a general policy, this is not going to be, senior high school is not what our SUC should be getting into, because at least the bigger SUCs must be going into research because they're the ones funded by government. Yeah.
Well,
that's
the other reason I ask is in terms of long-term preparation of an individual. If I was an ambitious individual and I know there's going to be a lot of ground for me to move along in this senior high thing, I can be a leader in my region, in my country, then I might pursue something senior high related. But if I know that, no, this is just limited, that the HEI I'm affiliated with is just, you know, trying to get by, then let me pursue a master's in line with me being back in the collegial level. So parang these are decisions that we have to start making.
Chair, my sense of DepEd is that it is not going to be the government is not going to cover senior high school over the long term. In other words, there will be a distribution, unless I'm wrong, there's a distribution, a certain part of it is DepEd, and there will be non-DepEd schools
yes.
that will be offering senior high school. So the non-DepEd schools will be offering for the longer term. I guess that's most of them will be offering in the long term and not just to survive.
When you say non-DepEd,
non-DepEd, the higher ed, kame.
No. That's why when you said there will be non-DepEd schools filling that gap, so these are private HEIs, SUCs, and
private
totally
schools.
New animals. Pwede ba yon? Yung magtatayo ka lang ng 2 year, ano? Like, yeah, I guess, especially for the vocational track, I guess.
In fact, Madam Chair, we are discovering very, very small higher education institutions that technically are not higher ed institutions. They have very small college programs, which could be under CHED, but some of them might be better off becoming standalone senior high school or a good senior high school program. So that is also part of the...
Well, but that is the other thing that I need to warn you of. If DepEd is moving... If that is DepEd's vision, you will receive some opposition if this is mostly privately owned, because education is supposed to be free in this country, especially. So just something to consider in your internal discussions, no? I mean, I'm just saying, you're going to encounter these issues if they're saying, ona dominate na ng private, no? So I don't think DepEd will be allowed to take a abandon ship position.
Actually, Madam Chair, it will never happen.
Yeah.
Because the DepEd share is much bigger than the non-DepEd.
I assume so naman, but I'm just saying na, just something to keep in mind that you always have that bigger share nga.
Madam Chair, a related question. How many private schools have already made the adjustment to K-12, meaning their students will already graduate in 2016? Because they just readjusted the... I know my where I graduate from Xavier, they did it, and I heard LaSalle also made the adjustment. So, ilan ba yon? Just to get an idea.
The adjustment you're referring to, Senator Angara, would be mainly for the private basic education schools that start grade 1 previously at age 7, a year older than what is prescribed by the law, and have typically 7 years of elementary. Again, 1 year longer than what is prescribed by law. In the previous system, their graduates finish fourth year high school age 17 or 18. And 3 years, 4 years ago, they approached us telling us if they just added 2 years, that would mean their students would graduate age 19 or 20, which is too old. There are about, I don't have the exact number, somewhere around 40 to 50 plus schools of these nationwide, but they're mainly in Metro Manila. A lot of them are Catholic schools. And these would be your Xavier, your Ateneo, your La Salle, your ICA, your Poveda, and so on.
It's really just a few. It really affects everybody. Yeah, go ahead, Commissioner.
Mr. Chair, there are about, I think DepEd has approved altogether around 346 or 325. Yeah, so some of them are actually offering senior high school already. And they will be graduating. So apart from that, the schools, the elite schools in Metro Manila, you have graduates from these schools. I was looking at the list. My God,
they're
some
offering
of our,
your curriculum?
The new senior high school curriculum. So some of our higher education institutions thought strategically and already offered in 2014. So they have graduates in 2016, and they would have they have a feeder school for their college. So in other words, we're realizing that you will still have students in college, but the schools that actually started offering earlier will have already their captive students.
Before I recognize Vice President, did I hear you right that you said there are about 700 high schools which are feeder high schools for universities? Parang there was something mentioned about an hour ago. You mentioned that,
We don't have the exact number, but around anywhere from 30 to 40% of private HEIs also offer high school.
Okay. All right. So yeah, you were raising your hand, and I'll go to the side.
Senator,
after.
I'm into trying to solve problems in the short term, the medium term, and the long term. So for solving the problem in the short term, if indeed DepEd has recognized that several hundreds of private high schools have the competency to recognize senior high school K-11-12 based achievement, then how about asking these high schools, as part of their public service, as part of their desire to help the whole country uplift the public school system, adopt a public school and invest in technology to increase the number of students and the effectiveness of teaching per teacher. Okay, so increasing the student to teacher ratio using technology, using larger classrooms, and then investing in some training themselves of the public school teachers. Because otherwise, if this happens and you just keep approving these high schools, the gap between the rich and the poor is going to grow even more. We know that. Okay? So that's one. UP is already offering to help train public school teachers for a minimum of 3 weeks. But the same principle could apply to selected SUCs that have competencies in STEM or other expert areas. But the fourth proposal for me is, how about getting the Philippine Science High Schools, Quezon City Science High Schools, Manila City Science High School, schools which we know are already on the level of STEM proficiency of the K-11 and 12, also do the same. Let's expand the capability of our science high schools, adopt a regular public high school, invest in the technology, invest in bigger classrooms and in MOOCs, in materials, almost require it. You know, if you're a private HEI and you're earning a lot of money, there's so much profit there, why don't you invest in partnering with a public high school in these areas? Short-term solution. There are many others, medium and the long-term.
Before you answer, I think some people who was raising their hand here. I saw it. No one? you made a reaction when they said you were making a lot of money.
There is a cost, kasi there's investment, and in the case of private tertiary education institutions, we are tuition dependent, so it will be difficult to invest if tuition dependent lang. Mahirap. Ngayon pa lang, mawawalan kami ng estudyante. So, and it's difficult for government to fund, as of now, to fund private tertiary education, or private education for that matter, because public funds are for public use. So that's the limitation. Although I will argue that education is a public function, because private education is actually complementary to public education. So anyway, that's only me.
Okay. Sorry, what did I miss? Who spoke?
Okay, balang. So we haven't moved here. Okay, time check lang. We should try to wrap it up and get on with our individual lives. So can we let everybody speak first and then maybe very quick reactions na lang? So I'll go back to what I tried to make our guiding principles, that let's have Ched react na lang in general towards the end, okay? So I left off with you, and then I guess it got shifted to a few comments here. So let's go back. Ms. Suarez, yes. And then Brother Bernie.
Yeah, thank you very
going
much.
Going back to transition.
Yes.
Well, this doesn't really affect you because you have nothing.
That's right.
But I had a question earlier in terms of preparation. When you have your teachers who are applying for the job, obviously there was previously no Philippine teaching college that was teaching senior high. So did you do your own in-house training?
Yes.
And how long is that? So that
Our training really is very strong. In fact, before we make them teach, we train them for almost 2.5 months. Yes. So we're putting in place, especially with the curriculum. Earlier, Senator Angara was asking about the leadership curriculum. In our school, it's not embedded this time. Sorry to borrow the word. It's really a separate subject. Yes. We start from grade one. We call it emotional quotient, achiever score training. Yes, because our vision mission is to develop leaders who will become movers of society or leaders with hearts of service, just like both of you, sir and now. And so it's aligned to our vision mission. And then it's a separate curriculum from grade one, and then stronger in, we have Book of Edinburgh. We offer that in grades 11 and 12. And then, yes, another leadership program is, and this time, integrated in our social studies, but it's a separate, aside from history, there's a leadership program, okay, that really will train them to become leaders. They were also mentioning about the training. The focus of our training is mainly on what to teach, how to teach, and how assessment is used. So we have programs, majors, ready for this. For 11 and 12, these are the standards that you need to teach, and then how to teach it, different approaches, and then assessments should not be forgotten, because these assessments are also tools for learning and teaching at the same time. In our own humble way, we have reached out to our neighboring schools. We offer free training for them. We would like them to know more about the K-12 in international schools, and actually the goal really is to make students globally competitive. Okay, so that's all. Thank you so much for inviting Southern International School and Colleges.
My last question was going to be, can you share that knowledge? So I'm really happy to know that, and it is not in a small way when you reach out to your country. And if you can expand that.
That's right.
Paranaque, Las Piñas,
Montero. Yes,
because I feel that you are in a unique situation.
Correct.
All these years of running a
K-12
STEM.
In fact, our curriculum have been visited and revisited by our accreditors, the Western Association of Schools and Colleges, which are expert implementers of K-12 curriculum.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Brother Bernie.
Well, the suggestion of the private schools helping public schools, we're doing that also.
Well, first of all, you have your whole evening
scholars, right.
Yeah.
But
which is how many, I'm just curious.
700. But I think De La Salle University is helping a lot also in training teachers to prepare for the 11 and 12. For our own transition, we are already identifying who will be the teachers that will be teaching the subjects that are required for 11 to 12. They're usually the senior teachers. If they need any more training, we will give that training to them also. But pretty much we chances are we will be getting from our own faculty.
Own pool, of course.
Yeah. So
and in your case, I'm assuming that this would just be upscaling them,
yes.
No, because they're used to dealing with your junior and senior, your current junior and senior. So just a little bit more of content, maybe to the extent that
Enriching. That's why we're working with the professors at De La Salle also. What more do we need to teach them to prepare them for university, for the university? Mm-hmm. But what is the concern that I have heard in our area is that there really are some small private high schools that will not be able to afford to do the 11 to 12. I really don't know the data, but it would be good if you find the information, because they will really need to go somewhere.
Yeah, and Chad, DepEd will have to take a active role in assuring the parents, because that's basically, well, Congress is the voice of the people, no? So my colleagues will be asking those questions, no? And we haven't even discussed much about those. It is a relatively small amount compared to the vast majority that are in public schools, but it still exists and it still will pose a problem. This is a little bit different, no? But can somebody confirm? A private school in Katipunan is a private college is closing its whole college for the next few years, and Ateneo will absorb their existing students because now they cannot afford to keep their instructors from 2016 onward.
Costca? We don't know. Costca?
No, I mean, let's not put it on record because baka mali yung info na tanggap ko. So, bulong ko na lang sa inyo mamaya.
A school in Katipunan?
No, college.
A college?
Well, college and high school. Oh, ilan lang ba yun?
College and high school.
Absorb ng Ateneo. Sino ba ba yung katabi
niya? No, I don't. Well, we don't know, but I don't think so. I don't think so, Madam Chair.
Yeah, I have not heard that.
We would have known. No.
There, I'm sure you would have known. Yeah, that's why no. I was quite surprised when I was told.
Yeah, no, I don't. No, I can almost say.
Wala kang alam. No. Walang ganun.
Also, no knowledge of that college. But what Ateneo will in fact do, and speaking as a Lasallian, what Ateneo will do, on top of addressing their own junior high completers, they will open up 300 slots for everyone else from. So essentially from public high schools, from like small parochial schools, and other private, yes.
But the info I got was from a source from that other school that absorbed ng Ateneo.
No.
And then including the reaction of Ateneo students na,
no.
Seriously, magkakaroon kami ng classmates na hindi galing sa amin.
No, Madam Chair.
Off the record, please.
Madam Chair, off the record. I know, and this is to confirm what Elvin is saying. Ateneo is expanding its senior high school, mm-hmm. but it is also very mindful of the possibility that if it did not make any restrictions, it would be absorbing the girls from the girls' schools, diba? The same way that Ateneo and La Salle actually absorb the girls from the girls' schools in college. That's why the elite of the private girls' schools went to the elite schools, the elite university. So they're very mindful of that. That's why they're opening to parochial schools, to public schools. Mm. So I'm sure, at least I'm sure off the record, that story about the other school in Katipunan being absorbed and the college closing, I think that's not offhand. I think we have not heard of it.
Off the record, I also...
So put off the record na.
No, because this...
Anyway, overtime involves, na yung ating mga ano, so...
it involves, Ateneo. I also heard that rumor, but the one that I heard is that it will... They said that Ateneo will lower its standards to... Because... They will lack college students for 2 years, so they will lower their standards to accept more... for their senior high school, but that is only a rumor. So I guess union, so it's off the record. The other one is the school that will close. Anyway, this is a public record, man. And the TRO, I think there was an injunction. It was PSBA that was rumored to be PSBA Quezon City. That was supposed to close. But it has nothing to do with K-12. So that's the PSBA QC in Katipunan.
Well, anyway, we can do more of this off the records later. Let's go back to on the record. Anything more, Brother Bernie, before I talk? Okay. So, Roger, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chairman. I keep hearing this word with the teacher training we are developing. this worries me because development is expensive, it takes a long time, it hasn't been tested, hasn't been trialled, isn't proven, so developing is a word that worries me. The direction we've been going as international education specialists is that we've gone to countries and universities where the materials for grades 11 and 12 already are developed. The methodology for delivering the content for the teacher training is developed. It is tried. It is tested. It's ready to go. It's on the shelf. It can be brought off the shelf. By this September, it can already be ready to roll out here in the Philippines. We're talking about creativity. We have to beware of looking too insular. If we want to raise the bar, we've got to go to places that have a high bar and grab some of their best ideas and shamelessly borrow them. Of course, they need to be contextualized. And there's things like mesh guides out there on the net for teachers all around the world where they can put their own research and ideas there, and the Philippines is included, and they can grab others so we can share and pool the best ideas for how to teach grades 11 and 12. These kind of programs need to be delivered through Philippine universities, the autonomous, the deregulated universities. The overseas university can come in and train their education faculty on how to help teachers, first of all, get to LET standard if their colleges, if they are professors being reskilled. They can then teach them how to deliver very specific subjects in science, maths, whatever, not the old teacher-centric model, but with the new approaches to teaching and approaches to learning, which is what 16, 17, 18-year-olds need. And then we can actually raise our whole academic standard. And if these can be jointly awarded from, say, the Philippines and the UK, we also remove all of the barriers within ASEAN, whereby the Philippine license is actually, the teaching license, is not actually recognized in ASEAN. But by having a joint award program, we exceed ASEAN standards, and our teachers become the elite of ASEAN, not playing catch-up. So there are some genuine solutions to this. They're cost-effective. They can be done. And they can be done quickly. As you said, if we start this next year or towards the end of next year, we've missed the boat. It has to start this year.
Okay, thank you. Do you have anything else to add, Mr. Rigor?
In terms of teacher training, how we plan to contribute to this, especially to the pool of new teachers, is through our scholarship program. Mainly, we have 1,000 slots for those who want to be teachers, but we allotted majority, like 700 of those slots, to CTP or Certificate in Teaching Program students. These are these are graduates of undergraduate degrees who just need to take several units, minimum of 18 units of education in order for them to take the LET or the board exam. Mm-hmm. So in effect, these are already content specialists. They just need the skills in order to teach. So that's something that we can explore maybe in the future if there is a lack of qualified content specialists who can teach in the public school system. So there.
Okay. Thank you so much. So just to wrap, as I said, no, this consider this a preparatory hearing or meeting to prepare DepEd mostly and CHED as their partner in the hearing that we will have in May, which is just like today, open to all the senators, but because we are on session break, a lot of other commitments all over the country and even abroad. They will ask you similar or maybe more detailed questions. And if I may ask that if you want to have meetings in between with my staff just to go through these questions, Senator Angara, of course, has been very active in education even when he was still in the House. We can have group meetings to help you, you know, prepare the answers that will need to be given to us. Specifically, today we focus on those two subject matters. I won't have a hearing between now and May, but my staff might have questions. Aside from me wanting to just understand the curriculum in greater detail, I post random questions. Maybe I can kind of summarize that, no? So we don't lose. We don't miss out on anything, but in terms of, like, you know, rolling out these plans for preparation, I do know for a fact that my brother, Senator Alan, and Senator Sonny Trillanes had specific questions on the physical capacity, no? So how many classrooms are there, and if you're going to now tie it into, we're building this much, SUCs are absorbing this much, they're going to need answers to those questions. And it's getting to the point where we can't say we'll know in a few months, you know, like a lot of these things have to already be answered, or if not clearly answered, with a very clear deadline on when it's going to be answered. The infrastructure, that's the classrooms, the human resource, the teachers, the training for the teachers, the materials, whether are they going to be produced, are there textbooks, are they online, and they're supposed to, they're going to ask you these kind of questions. So that's what it is. In between then and now, let's just continue to communicate to help you get to the bottom of these answers. Yes.
Madam Chair, just maybe developing is, it's unfortunate I use the word, but we don't refer to developing as developing from scratch. Precisely the whole point is there's so much material there. We are actually in touch with IBDP. We cannot afford IBDP, but we are really coordinating with different people. So it is not like, maybe developing is the wrong word, but it's putting together the materials that would be necessary that can be accessible, but also curating the materials and getting the experts so that content is contextualized. Mm-hmm. So because the content is already there, we just want to clarify that we are in touch with the different groups, and it is not like the Filipinos coming together again and starting from scratch as we always do when we talk about developing. Mm-hmm. So I guess that's something that, yeah, so we understand the concern. It will take a long time. That's why we're saying it's up to September only, because it is not developing and validating. We're already looking at validated materials and just seeing how you can put content in context. Thank you.
So this hearing is, any further? Okay. This hearing is suspended till the hearing on May 5. May 5. But we haven't set a time, but most likely 10 o'clock, so we have a lot of time. But you will get official invitations. Thank you very much, everyone.
Tuesday. No, three ang Sunday. 4-5, Tuesday. Kasi may hearing daw ang house ng 4. So 5 tayo. Same. Si Kimi ba is pro, ano?